new versions.
So, hi everyone. I'm Romain Parillo, application specialist at Stila Technologies. Firstly, I would like to thank the organizer of the conference for giving us the opportunity to present our system despite the pandemic context that we are currently facing. I also thank you for taking the time to watch this short presentation on Crystal Digital PCR detection kit for SARS-CoV-2. So, clinical symptoms of COVID-19 are difficult to distinguish from other respiratory infections. Thus, detection of nucleic acid sequences has rapidly become a standard to diagnose SARS-CoV-2. Especially, RT-qPCR has been extensively used since the COVID-19 outbreak. However, many reports have shown patients displaying chest computed tomography abnormalities, but being initially RT-qPCR negative for SARS-CoV-2. Only a few days after onset, the RT-qPCR for SARS-CoV-2 were appearing positive for these patients. And additionally, other reports tend to show a limitation of sensitivity of RT-qPCR around 50 to 70% for SARS-CoV-2. So there is a necessity to develop more sensitive detection tools where digital PCR could have an advantage. So how does digital PCR work? Digital PCR is the third generation of the well-known polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. First generation of PCR is based on amplification of a target and to detect whether the amplicon is present or not on an electrophoresis gel. Then came the quantitative PCR, where the amplification is monitored during the amplification cycle, and qPCR results are given in CT value, which is not a result by itself, requiring the use of standard curves or reference gene to obtain a concrete result. On the contrary, digital PCR allows an absolute quantification, meaning each point is a result in copy per microliter. So no standard curves are needed. And digital PCR allows an increased sensitivity and higher precision. And digital PCR, with its improved sensitivity, might bring important information to manage a COVID-19 outbreak. For example, gain in sensitivity might allow to have a larger overview of the virus infection timeline, where its charge might be lower at the onset or at the remission. As another example, nucleic acid conversion cases have been reported. However, it is not so clear if they are real event or if RT-qPCR lack of sensitivity could explain this observation. Digital PCR gain of sensitivity could give a hint in these various open questions, among also other questions. So, how does digital PCR work? As in qPCR, you prepare your sample and your master mix. The first step will be to divide your bulk of measurement in many thousand droplets of the same size. This step is the partitioning and will dilute the genetics complexity. As partitions are generated, the target sequences are randomly distributed in the droplet, as such as some droplets will contain one or more of the target of interest, and some won't contain any. Then start the PCR, leading to the generation of a fluorescent signals in all droplets that initially contain at least one target of interest. In the right panel, you can see a dot plot showing the fluorescence intensity of on the y-axis, and where each dot is representing a droplet. We can observe two clusters, the positive cluster on top and the negative cluster just down. Once fraction of positive and negative droplets determined, applying the Poisson statistic law will allow to calculate the concentration of the target of interest together with the uncertainty of the measurement. So now I'm going to briefly introduce you to our Crystal Digital PCR platform, Astilla Technologies, the NAICA system. So the first element, the Sapphire chip, which is the only consumable needed in the NAICA system workflow. Sapphire chips contain four wells already pre-filled with oil. Then you just need to add 25 microliters of your sample and mix into the Y-cap inlet. It is a patented partitioning technology called droplet crystal. Sapphire chips are going to generate up to 30,000 droplets, and the droplet volume being 0.59 nanoliters. Once sample loaded in the chips, you place them into the NAICA geode. The NAICA geode can receive up to 3 chips, meaning up to 12 samples per run with one geode. The first step in the geode is an increase of pressure, leading to a contactless fluid injection, pushing the sample towards the microfluidic in the chips and generating the droplet with a tightly controlled size, as you can see in the video here. Directly after the partition, the PCR amplification starts with the same instrument as in a regular PCR instrument. Once amplification is done, we place the chips in the prism-free imaging system to read the droplet fluorescence. The reading is assessed in 10 minutes in 3 different channels, blue, green, red, allowing to easily multiplex 3 targets. And the specification here of each channel make it compatible with widely used fluorophores in qPCR. Finally, our software Crystal Miner integrates all droplet fluorescence, allowing an easy analysis of the result within the different channels. Crystal Miner is available with no limitation on seats or licensing fees. It can be downloaded together with demo data via Astilla Technologies website. So, to sum up, the NAICA system workflow allows you to get results in 2.5 hours with a minimum hands-on time. And the integration of the whole workflow within the Sapphire chip make it very easy to use. And after a proof of concept in China, Astilla Technologies has developed a novel RUO kit for COVID-19 detection in human sample. We took advantage of the free color capability of the NAICA system to detect 2 viral genes, ORF1AB and nucleoprotein N. The 2 are reported conserved region of the SARS-CoV-2 detected in the here in the FAM and X and FAM channels respectively. Also, a human housekeeping gene is used and, as an endogenous control detected in the red channels Psi-5. You can see on the dot plot typical results we will obtain in digital PCR, showing positive droplets in green and blue channel. The kit contains all primer and probes, the RT-PCR master mix, the Sapphire chip, as well as the COVID-19 positive and negative control used to validate each run. Currently, this kit is for research purpose only. And here are some data generated by Stila's R&D, showing here the sensitivity and specificity of the kit to detect SARS-CoV-2. In this experiment, plasmids were used as positive controls containing the viral gene ORF1AB and nucleoprotein N. This positive control was serially diluted and tested in triplicate. 8 microliters of the positive control was assessed in a 25 microliters reaction. 1 nanogram of human RNA was also run in each experiment. The kit has shown to reliably detect viral sequences down to 5 and 7 copies per 25 microliters reaction for ORF1AB and nucleoprotein N respectively. Importantly, no false positive droplets were observed in 15 negative controls containing 1 nanogram of human RNA. Now, here are preliminary results obtained with CHU de Rennes, France. As other reports describing, they observed multiple cases of patients showing chest computed tomography abnormalities, strongly suggesting a COVID-19 infection in this pandemic context. But where the qPCR of nasopharyngeal swab were negative in first instance for the SARS-CoV-2. So this could suggest a low viral charge in nasopharyngeal swab at this time of infection. In a retrospective manner, we decided to investigate with our COVID-19 detection kit and the NAICA system both RNA extractions of patients positive for CT chest but negative for qPCR. On 10 patients included in this preliminary retrospective study, we observed 4 patients positive for SARS-CoV-2 using our kit. This data suggests that our system could bring relevant clinical information at the first onset of the infection when the viral charge might still be low in a nasopharyngeal swab. So Stila recently collaborated with University Hospital of Mediterranean Infection Marseille, France. Here, patient samples originally tested by qPCR were evaluated with Crystal Digital PCR. Especially, we focused on difficult to interpret high CT values patient samples obtained in qPCR, called here the doubtful. The negative and positive group, as determined by qPCR, were also evaluated. In the negative or undetermined group, Crystal Digital PCR identified and recalled one sample out of 15 as testing positive for SARS-CoV-2. The results from the positive group were used to try and determine a correlation between Crystal Digital PCR and qPCR results. Data on the positive samples show correlation for OF1AB and nucleoprotein N. However, a full correlation could not be reached as qPCR is not standardized and the patient's samples were collected, extracted, and performed from different series. Finally, the doubtful or any samples with a CT value greater than 34 CT has been investigated by Crystal Digital PCR and the COVID-19 detection kit. Here, the table is showing a designation of positive or negative for the viral sequence of SARS-CoV-2. 7 of the 18 samples tested were confirmed as negative, while SARS-CoV-2 sequence was confirmed in 11 of the 18 samples tested by Crystal Digital PCR. In this dataset, the highest CT value where virus was confirmed with Crystal Digital PCR was 37.43 CT. To note, our internal human endogenous control has revealed a possible extraction, collection, or amplification issue on one of these samples. This data highlight use of Crystal Digital PCR COVID-19 detection kit as an easy and fast solution to investigate difficult to interpret qPCR high CT value data. So to conclude, we have seen that Crystal Digital PCR COVID-19 detection kit allows you to detect only few copies of the SARS-CoV-2. Secondly, that it could potentially bring relevant clinical information at the first onset of the infection when SARS-CoV-2 charge might still be low. And finally, Crystal Digital PCR COVID-19 detection kit is an easy and fast solution to investigate this difficult to interpret high CT value qPCR data. So I would like to give a special thank you to the CHU Rennes and IHU Marseille. And also I want to thank you for your time. And I'm now happy to answer your question.
Thanks, Ramon. Very informative. We've got several questions. The first one is, what do we know about the pre-analytical factors that may affect the assay? One of the things that I've heard is that, and unfortunately experience, is that as a larger fraction as 50 to 60% of samples perform inappropriately because of pre-analytical variation. Can you comment on that?
Yeah. I think it's a really important question, and I think there is different explanation, or at least a way to think about this. And to me, so far, the kinetic of the viral charge in the different organs or the different tissue is not fully understood. And there was a publication in JAMA that was showing that the collection site with the highest viral charge might vary from patient to patient between the different collection sites, for example, nasal, pharyngeal, sputum, or anal swab. So it's one of the pre-analytical factors that might lead to this observation.
Thank you.
I think also there are RNA is less stable than DNA, so we have to take many precautions during all this process, from the sample collection, the RNA extraction, and the conservation, to avoid any degradation of this viral RNA. I think with our kit here, we have an endogenous human control inside the kit, and I think it's a good things to have to make sure that all this process during the extraction, the collection, and the PCR by itself, there was no issue during all this step.
Thank you. And what is the status of FDA authorization of Krystal Digital PCR?
We did submit the COVID-19 detection kit with Krystal Digital PCR for FDA fast track approval, so the emergency use authorization that you were mentioning. As far as I know, it is in the hand of a regulatory affair for now, so I don't have much more information. But meanwhile, this kit has been tested and approved by a National Center of Reference, the Institut Pasteur, CDC, here in France, where you can find the report online.
Thank you. And is this same technology being used for an existing cleared or approved diagnostic assay?
So far, the Krystal Digital PCR COVID-19 kit will be our first kit for in vitro diagnostic purpose. I don't think there are a lot of IVD or FDA-approved digital PCR assay in the market. As I think it might be explained as digital PCR is relatively new compared to qPCR on the market.